Okay, now we're looking at parables of Jesus, and we're looking at the parables that I've grouped under the heading, "The Kingdom is Bad News for the Establishment." And last week we looked at the parable of the two sons in Matthew 21, and when the class ended, we just started looking at the parable of the wicked tenants, which is in Matthew 21, Mark 12, and Luke chapter 20. Now let's read again the parable from Matthew 21, just to remind you of the text, and I'll repeat a bit of what I said last week, and then we'll move on. Matthew 21, 33 to 46. Hear another parable. There was a master of a house who planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a wine press in it and built a tower and leased it to tenants and went into another country. When the season for fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to get his fruit. And the tenants took his servants and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other servants, more than the first, and they did the same to them. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, "They will respect my son." But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and have his inheritance." And they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. When therefore the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the fruits in their seasons." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruits. And the one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and when it falls on anyone, it will crush him." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they perceived that he was speaking about them. And although they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds because they held him to be a prophet. Now the vineyard, you will recall, it represents Israel. And those tending the vineyard, Israel's leaders, they had failed to produce from Israel the fruit of righteousness that God is due. God had repeatedly sent prophets to Israel to urge the people to be faithful to his covenant, to give him his due as God. But the leaders had shamefully treated those prophets. And we could go back through history and look at how they had treated them. Jesus was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now you see that in Matthew chapter 15, 21 to 24. Also in Matthew 10, 5 and 6. Jesus was the son coming after many prophets had been sent. He was the son coming to call Israel again to repent, to give God the fruit he was due, to give him the righteousness that he was due. And he comes calling them to repent, but this time in light of the kingdom's arrival. So he comes bringing the blessings of the kingdom, the receipt of which requires faith in him as the Messiah, which includes a genuine commitment to holy living. You remember when Jesus is preaching, what? Repent, the kingdom is at hand. You see, you put your trust in him as the Messiah, which includes this commitment to holy living. He's the Son coming, calling the people to give God his due. And so this is exactly what you have happening in the parable. And rather than accept Jesus as the master's son, rather than accept him as the one who came in the fullness of the master's authority, the religious leaders, they are challenging his authority. You see that in Matthew chapter 21, verse 23. And ultimately, they will kill him, as the tenants in the parable kill the master's son. So that's what they're going to wind up doing to him. And after telling that the tenants kill the master's son, Jesus asked in verse 40, "When therefore the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" And then you have the religious leaders, They answered and they say, he'll put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the fruits in their seasons. And in doing that, in giving that answer, they once again pass judgment on themselves. Jesus is a master at laying out for them, asking them the question, and then having them pronounce judgment on themselves without knowing it. And so that's what they do once again. Now Jesus, he brings the point home by citing Psalm 118, verses 22 to 23. Have you never read in the scriptures, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. You see, the rejected one, the son who is killed, the son who is rejected, becomes the preeminent one by the will of God. And David Wenham remarks on this. He says, the saying about the stone supplements the parable and in a sense completes it. Since the one rejected and killed, as the parable describes, was in due course to be the risen Lord and the cornerstone in the saved people of God. We have commented before on the limitations of parables. And Jesus' parable of the vineyard is limited precisely in the fact that it leaves the son dead. To have had the son of the story rise from the dead would have altered the character of the parable as a picture taken from everyday life. So in using the stone saying, Jesus, who regularly spoke of his death and resurrection together, supplements the parable of the vineyard with another parable of resurrection as we may regard it. You see, that's what he's talking about. The stone the builders rejected, the son who was killed, has become what? The cornerstone, the chief stone. You see, and this is, he's become the preeminent one by the will of God. Now Jesus adds that their rejection of him will mean that the kingdom of God, for which Israel was first in line for the kingdom of God, so much so that they're called the sons of the kingdom. In Matthew chapter 8, verse 12, he says that the kingdom of God for which they were first in line will be denied to them. You see, their expectation will be taken away and given to another nation, meaning the holy nation that is the church, as Peter describes it in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. The church being that faithful subset of ethnic Israel, right? You have ethnic Israel, by which I mean the descendants, physical, natural Israel. And then you have a faithful subset of Jews. Who are those? Those are those who have the faith to trust God when he testifies about Jesus. So you have a faithful subset of ethnic Israel, which is true Israel. And then into that root of true Israel, the faithful subset of ethnic Israel, will be grafted the Gentiles who share in the faith in Jesus. And that grafting in, we then have new spiritual Israel. So we have Israel, we have true Israel, and we have new Israel, spiritual Israel. And so he says, it's going to be taken from you, your expectation as Jews, sons of the kingdom. It is going, because of your rejection, is going to be taken from you and given to another nation. You see, David Wenham remarks on this. He says, the parable is thus an indictment of the political and religious leadership of the vineyard, Israel, but also a warning that the people whom they represent will come under divine judgment. The parable could be read as a warning to only the current leaders of the Jews that they would be displaced, rather than as a warning of judgment on the nation of Israel as a whole. But it is clear from Jesus' teaching elsewhere that Jerusalem and the Jewish nation as a whole face judgment, and that although the opposition to Jesus in the nation is not universal, see the disciples, the whole nation is implicated in the actions of its leaders. So ethnic Israel. Ethnic Israel as led and represented by Christ rejectors. See, ethnic Israel as led and represented by Christ rejectors, which describes the nation proper at that time. Those people, see, they forfeit the kingdom blessings that the nation was to enjoy. But ethnic Israel as led and represented by the apostles of Christ. See, true Israel, that subset that was faithful, that shared the faith of Abraham, that believed God's testimony about his son. See, ethnic Israel as led and represented by the apostles of Christ, they received the blessings of the kingdom along with the later Gentiles of like faith. It is this holy nation. It is spiritual Israel. It is ethnic Israel, the true Israel that is the subset with the Gentiles grafted in, that is the church, the holy nation that Peter describes in 1 Peter 2:9, that then receives the glory of being God's vehicle for blessing the world. Right? The Great Commission? You go out in there and see who's doing that. Who is this holy nation that is now God's, the glory of being God's vehicle for what? Blessing the world. You see, this was Israel. And Israel, as led and represented by Christ rejectors, has forfeited that. But Israel, as led and represented by the apostles, true Israel, that subset into which the Gentiles are grafted, this holy nation will receive the glory of being God's vehicle for blessing the world. Now, so this parable, you see, it resonates with Jesus' lament in Matthew 23, verses 37 and 38. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. Well, that's the parable, right? He's sending many to you, and what are you doing? Mistreating them, killing them. Then he sends his son. Now listen to my son. He said, how often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you would not. He's here coming, urging, appealing, and they reject him, and you would not. He says, see, your house is left to you desolate. So this is what has happened, and this is what he's saying. Now the statement in verse 44, and the one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. This seems to be a proverbial statement. Perhaps it's rooted in Isaiah chapter 8, verses 14 and 15, and Daniel chapter 2, verses 44 and 45, that here what it is doing, it expresses the danger of being at odds with the Messiah stone of verse 42. Donald Hagner comments on this. He says, here it is the rejected stone, now the cornerstone. See, the son who was killed, rejected. Now what? The preeminent one by God's will and God's work through the resurrection. He says, who becomes to those who have rejected him either the stone of stumbling or the stone that crushes, in both cases bringing ruin to them. You see, so that's what he's telling them here. You see, this is this idea. The danger of being at odds with the stone that was rejected and became the preeminent one. There's tremendous danger and risk of being at odds with the Messiah stone. You're doomed. You will be crushed. You will wind up in that situation. Now the chief priests and the elders, they understood that Jesus was speaking about them. They understood that. But despite that, the fact that he's warning them about being crushed by rejecting God's cornerstone, and they know he's talking about them. Verse 46 reports that it's their intent to arrest him. So they know he's talking about them. They know he's saying to them there is danger in rejecting the preeminent stone, the Messiah stone. And yet, what are they doing? They're going to arrest him. The only reason they don't arrest him is because they feared the crowds who believed Jesus was a prophet, and that restrained them. So that's what Jesus says there. Then we next get the parable of the wedding banquet and the feast. under this grouping here of the kingdom is bad news for the establishment. The parable of the wedding banquet you get in Matthew 22, verses 1 to 14, and the parable of the feast in Luke 14, verses 16 to 24. Now, these are variations of a parable that Jesus told on different occasions. Now, as I've said, this always comes up, but some scholars reject that suggestion, claiming that the differences in the parables that you have in Matthew 22, 1 to 14, and Luke 14, 16 to 24, that these are the result of later alterations of a single original parable. Or they say, no, no, that's not what's happening. He's not varying the parable and telling it differently and using it differently on different occasions. No, 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 you just have this one parable and it's being altered and garbled as it's being reported. Okay? Here's what Snodgrass says about that. He says, I find it hard to accept that one account stands behind the two quite different accounts in Matthew and Luke. Why is this parable so different if both accounts are from the same source? Is it not likely that Jesus spoke a given parable on a number of occasions and in different contexts, adapting it each time, perhaps to the circumstances? A parable like that of the banquet, especially if it was a challenge to Jesus' contemporaries, may have been told numerous times in various places and forms. And that makes perfect sense to me, as I told you. Jack Lewis said, if Jesus told stories only once, he's the only preacher to ever do that. And so that's, of course, this just makes perfect sense. But you see these skeptics want to say, no. Bible, unreliable. He said this, and they just kind of changed it. But I want you to see that that's just an assumption that you have some scholars, skeptical scholars, making that I think it has no basis. Now, the parable of the wedding banquet in Matthew chapter 22, 1 to 14, this is the last in the set of three parables that speak of the Jewish leadership's rejection of God's kingdom call. We had the parable of the two sons, we have the parable of the wicked tenants, and then you get this parable. You get the parable of the wedding banquet. And let me say, before we look at the parable of the wedding banquet in Matthew, when you have somebody like Klein Snodgrass who says Matthew's version is enough to make any interpreter go weak in the knees, I consider it among the most difficult parables of all. So when you have somebody like that saying that, that's kind of a caution to you. You know, you just say, okay, humility required as we go and try to unpack what is being said here. But we have the parable. He says in 22, 1 to 14, and again Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son and sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again, he sent other servants, saying, tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast. But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. The king was angry and sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, the wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you find. And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to look at the guests, he saw there was a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment? And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, bind him hand and foot and cast him into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. So here we have, that's the text of the parable. Now, as you may have heard, may know, that in the ancient Near East, there was a double invitation process for large feast. You had this double invitation process. There was an invitation to which one needed to respond so the host would know for how many people he needed to prepare. Something like an RSVP. I'm inviting you. You tell me if you're coming. I then know how many animals have to be slaughtered and how big this thing's going to be and that kind of thing. So you had that initially. And those acceptances, how many people accepted, determined the animals that should be butchered. And because the time to prepare, this was difficult to determine in advance, it was standard procedure to send a second invitation at the appropriate hour, which was really an announcement that the feast was now ready. It was an announcement that things are now set, it's time to come. And in the parable, see, the servants are informing those who had already accepted the king's invitation that now it's ready. Now it's time to come. And you have to realize that to reject a king's invitation to a feast, this would be a slap in the face. This would be an insult to his dignity, let alone reneging on one's prior acceptance. When he invites, you say, I'm coming. He then says, it's ready, and you say, buzz off. Well, this would be an insult to his dignity and a reneging of your prior acceptance. And you see, attending was a social obligation that simply could not be refused. We have social obligations that border on that, right? I mean, there's some things you just can't say no to. And that's how this was. A king's invitation was something that there was absolutely no way that it could be refused. And the fact that the invited guests, they ignored the call to come to the feast, this would have left the original hearers of this parable cringing. We don't have that, you know, it's just, but when somebody heard that in that social context, when he's telling this parable, the king's feast, and the people blow the king off, the original people heard that would say, this is just absolutely, absolutely unthinkable. Now, the fact all of them ignored the king's call, not just one, all of them ignored the king's call suggests clearly that this was an intent to insult the king. So we wind up, yeah, we're going to come slaughter, get all this stuff ready, and when you come to us, we're not coming. It was an intent to insult the king, and you can get some sense of the seriousness of dishonoring someone in an honor-shame culture from David's reaction to Nabal's snubbing of his request. You remember 1 Samuel chapter 25? It's hard for us to relate to some of these things. But the act of dishonoring somebody when David says, I've looked out for you and here, why don't you give my guy something to eat? He says, this is David, dude. All kinds of people breaking away from their masters these days. You know what, I got some wild man running out here and he's going to ask me something. Sends it back. This was dishonoring. And you see, David's going to go and take him out. And then, of course, you know the rest of the story, he's prevented. But in the parable here, the king goes the extra mile. He sends out people and says, it's now ready. So come on, the feast is prepared. And they say no. And then he goes the extra mile and he sends a second group of servants to call those who were invited, who explain the preparations that have been made, presumably to entice the guests to come. So it's like the king's really almost begging them. He says, here, come. They say, we're not coming. He sends a second group to say, this has been butchered and all of this has been done and we're all ready. So come, won't you come to the feast? And he does that. He sends the second one. And the fact that they not only ignore the second group, but some of them actually mistreat them and kill them, it leaves absolutely no doubt that this is enemy action. You see, this is enemy action. This is an act of rebellion amounting to a declaration of war against the king. When the king is doing something for you, not only are you, all of you together in concert, telling the king, buzz off, we're not coming, and insulting the king. When he sends the second group of people laying out for you all the preparations to entice you to come and you kill his messengers. Well, now you see what's happening, right? This is rebellion. That's what is involved in this. It's an act of war, see, which explains his destroying them and his burning of their city. That's what this is. As Craig Keener notes in his commentary, he says, the parable's audience would naturally applaud the king's rage as just. We look at it and go, oh, he's destroying the city? The people who heard this would applaud. But of course the king, who invited them and was snubbed and then had them attack and murder his agents, well, the king's not going to sit here and say, well, that's okay. You know, I think open rebellion against me is okay. No. So they would be applauding the king's reaction here as something that is just. Now, the upshot of these events and the first point of the parable is that those not expected to be at the feast, those initially not invited, they end up receiving the king's bounty, whereas those expected to be at the feast, those initially invited, they end up receiving the king's wrath. That's the point. That's the first point of the parable. And this is the same kind of reversal that you saw in the parable of the two sons, right? Where the tax collectors and prostitutes are entering the kingdom ahead of, meaning in place of. They are entering the kingdom in place of the religious elite. And just what we saw in the parable of the wicked tenants, where the kingdom is what? Forfeited by its presumptive recipients and given to others. So this is what you're seeing. Again, this is the third in a parable, in a series. And you're seeing this reversal of expectations where those you thought were going to have it wind up not having it. And those tax collectors, prostitutes, those other people, Gentiles, you thought weren't going to be getting it, they wind up receiving it. Now, the fact that the unexpected, those who get the king's bounty, whereas the expected, those who are invited, do not. The fact the unexpected are not invited until the expected refuse their invitation is not teaching a chronology of God's kingdom calling. It's simply a way of creating a reversal of expectations within the confines of the parable. See, since everybody would be expected to accept the king's invitation, you cannot have a reversal of expectations unless you don't invite some people. You see, so it's just a way within the parable of creating differing expectations. It is not about a chronology of God's kingdom calling. You see, without that group in the parable, there can be no reversal of expectations. And that's the first point of the parable, is that we're having this reversal. So that's why it's in there. Let me read to you what Snodgrass says about that. He says, to worry over the fact that the parable depicts the host as inviting the wealthy and only later turning to the poor, as though this is some precise, this is how it actually goes, he does this, rather than seeing this, see as part of the structure of the parable, to create the differing expectations. You can't, with the king inviting, create differing expectations unless you don't have somebody, people who aren't invited, because everyone would be expected to accept the king's invitation. So it's just part of the parable. See, that's why I say reading parables requires some deftness and some understanding, and it's partly why there's room for so much argument about it. He says, to worry over the fact the parable depicts the host as inviting the wealthy and only later turning to the poor, as if God and Jesus became interested in the poor and outcast only after other people rejected, is allegorizing and assumes that every feature of the analogy must mirror reality. Such thinking also assumes that narrative time corresponds to real time, which is not true. Parable chronology is not real-time chronology. A parable is a partial picture of reality, and it holds up part of reality to make a specific point or points, sometimes in an extreme fashion. Parables must be allowed to mirror the portion of reality they wish and not forced to picture a systematic theology or a chronology in toto. This is what I'm saying to you. The idea that in the parable, you have this reversal of expectations created by, well, it's only after the expected deny that we then have the invitation going, that's not the kingdom calling. The kingdom is open to all people. But what it is doing, it's showing the reversal of expectations. The Jewish leaders who look to be sitting pretty, who reject Jesus, are out. All of the other people who embrace the Messiah are in. The Jewish leaders' expectation was what? Who in the world? These prostitutes, these tax collectors, are you kidding me? No way they're coming in the kingdom. Ah. You, on the other hand, are sitting pretty. You are first in line of the kingdom. What's going to happen? Reverse. You, through your rejection, are out. They, through their embrace, are in. So this is this idea, this reversal of expectations. John Noland, in his commentary on Luke, he says, the reaching out to the poor and disabled corresponds to the ministry of Jesus himself. But of course, in reality, it needs no basis in some change of plan on the part of God. That is only part of the need to provide storyline motivation. You see, this is part of how parables function, and you got to have a smell for this, a sense for this. And I think otherwise you can go off course and get in trouble. Now, since burning of cities, this was a common occurrence in war. The burning of cities was a common occurrence. The destroying of the feast rejectors and the burning of their cities, this is a fitting picture of the king's wrath. That's what this is. It's a picture of the king's wrath, and it symbolizes God's exclusion and punishment of the religiously privileged Jews who not only were unreceptive to his summons, but who, in keeping with their history of killing those sent to them, like in Matthew 23, I just read verse 37, they had killed John. In keeping with that history, they had killed John, and would soon mistreat and kill Christ's disciples. So this is the king's wrath. It is a picture of the king's exclusion and wrath. And the breadth of the kingdom call in the gathering into the feast of all whom the king's servants could find. That's what you're seeing there. That's expressed in that. Go get everybody. Okay, so the religiously privileged through their rejection are out. Well, then go get everybody into the kingdom, bad and good. You see, so I could have put this in the thing, this kingdom is good news for the needy, right? There are elements of this, of course, that would fit there. But you see, go out and you get find both bad and good. See, no one is to be excluded from the invitation because of how they had lived. There is no life you could have lived that bars you from the invitation to the kingdom of God. I've said this to you many times. I don't care what you did, how often you did it, how long you did it, how ugly it was, how ashamed of it you are. You pick in your mind the worst thing people can do. Go out and collect them, the bad and the good. You see, this is the kingdom call. This is what's shown there, you see. God wants a large crowd at the feast. And so the invitation goes. Now, though all manner of people are summoned, accepting the invitation, you see, it carries with it a responsibility to be properly respectful to the king. It carries this sense, this responsibility to be respectful to the king. And that's the second point of the parable. You see, the first point of the parable is this reversal of expectations, where those first in line, the religious elite, because of their rejection of the Messiah, that those who were presumptive kingdom recipients have that taken to them, and those who actually receive it are those they thought would never get a taste of it because they embrace him. This reversal of expectations. But the second point that you have here is that one cannot accept the invitation with a spirit of defiance. See, with an intention to give God less than his due. That's what's behind the man who's condemned for not wearing a wedding garment. You see, he wanted to accept the invitation on his own terms. He wanted to accept it without caring about God's honor. He wanted to accept it and come in and dishonor God and say, here, I'm here, you're going to take me anyway. And that's not the way it goes. See, whether the host at such a feast, you may have sometimes heard that the host at such a feast would provide a wedding garment. Well, whether that's true, most people think that's probably not true. But whether that's the case, that he would provide the wedding garment, or whether a wedding garment meant only one's best, clean, available attire, it's clear that the person here, he made no effort to wear something fitting for the feast. He made no effort to wear something fitting and appropriate for the king's wedding feast, and thus showed contempt for the king and his banquet. His culpability, his guilt is evident when the king gives him a chance to explain himself, and what does he do? He's speechless. You see, it's not that he said, oh, well, let me tell you. Oh, no, you know, I didn't have anything. You know, I was on my way and I had clean things and this pot fell on me. And there's none of that. He's speechless. And see, his being speechless is his acknowledgement of his guilt. He's culpable. He just thought, what do I care? Feast? I'll go and get some food. And I don't care about the honor of the king. No. You see, we don't accept the invitation. It's open to everybody. But when we come in as different people. See, we come in as people who acknowledge the glory of the king, and we come bent on honoring the king. And so that's what's happening. That's what's going on here, you see. R.T. France, in his commentary on Matthew, he says, the clothing expected at a wedding was not a special garment like our mourning dress, but decent, clean, white clothes such as anyone should have had available. I mean, if you didn't have them available, which would be unusual, a neighbor, somebody would give you that, if you cared, okay? It says, in that case, the man's fault is that even though invited to a royal wedding, he had not gone home to change into his best. To turn up in ordinary dirty clothes was an insult to the host. The symbolism is of someone who presumes on the offer of salvation by assuming that therefore there are no obligations attached. Someone whose life belies their profession. Faith without works. Oh, I believe, yes, Jesus, yes, yes. I'm going to live the way I want. I'm going to lie, I'm going to stone, I'm going to get drunk, I'm going to commit adultery, I'm going to be sexually immoral. I'm going to live the way I want. And then I'll have the great sin cleanser in the sky who I reject by my life. I'm telling you, that is a lie. It's a joke and a sick one. Okay, a sick one. You cannot read this book and come away with that. He goes on, he says, entry to the kingdom of heaven may be free, but to continue in it carries conditions. Even though this man belongs to the new group of invitees, he is one who produces no fruit and so is no less liable to forfeit his newfound privilege than those who were excluded before him. What happened to him? He's cast out, weeping and gnashing of teeth. Right? So that's the image of hell. And this is this idea, you see, that when people come into the kingdom, it is by God's grace. He offers it to everyone. No one is barred by what they have done. But he offers this to people. And then when we come and embrace it, we are somebody who says, yes, Jesus, you are Lord. I trust who you are and what you've revealed and what you've done for me. And my life is now yours. What you call me to do in my life, I'm given to you in doing it. So where in that is room to continue living the way you were? How can you do that? How can there not be a radical transformation from the way I'm living when I don't believe Jesus is Lord to my turning and saying, I am now ready, I believe He's Lord and I'm giving Him my life? Well, don't you see how that will inevitably impact how you live? How can it not? Now, does that mean you're perfect? I always have to add this. Because people, you're a works guy. Does it mean you're perfect? Does it mean that you will flawlessly live out that commitment? Well, of course not. That will not happen until your sanctification is finalized and complete at the second coming. But that is a completely different question than, do I take the Lord's will seriously in my life and strive to do it? Do I treat it cavalierly? Do I blow it off? Do I use my relationship to Christ as a tool for manipulating people? Or am I sincere and devout in my conviction that Jesus is Lord? If that's the case, there's going to be a radical transformation. Not to mention, the Spirit of God works in your life to transform you and to empower you to live this out. So given those things, you see, and that's what's behind this. This guy just comes in, I think I'm going to come in. I want the benefits, but I'm not going to break or be submissive to God. I'm going to come in, with an attitude. Yeah, I'm here, and you're fortunate that I decided to wander in my grubby clothes, because even good then you're fortunate to have. All right, you see the idea. And this is just a message. I just think we have to see the people. We have to get them to understand. You cannot masquerade as a Christian and think God doesn't know it. You cannot be going home and rifling through pornography or reading it, looking at it on the internet, just consuming it and saying, so what? Nobody knows? Do you see how fraudulent that is? If you're doing that, you need to repent of it. The door is open, always open for the penitent. But you have to repent. You cannot wall off part of your life and say, I'm going to be the king of this part of my life. When you took on Christ, you said, here it is, Lord, lock, stock, barrel. You put your finger on anything in my life, whether it's lying, stealing, anything. And I surrender it to you because you are Lord and you died for me. Okay, you do that for a lot of people if they did for you what He did, not to mention that He's Lord. All right, so verse 14, it sums up the parable. Verse 14 sums it up, says, many are invited, but fewer than that are chosen. Many are invited, but fewer than that are chosen to receive the blessings, because fewer than that will respond to the invitation in genuine faith. Isn't that what we see? Oh God, so there's no, the kingdom is open to everybody. And so many are invited, but few will receive the benefits, relatively few. Now, the version of the parable in Luke 14, it varies from this one. The storyline is essentially the same. It varies from this, but I did hear that second bell, so thanks for coming. Pick up next week on it.